probably be.
At 7.
I decided.
Probably questioning why I entitled my sermon The Walking Dead. Some of you know this, some of you don't know this about me. Today's, since it's Memorial Day weekend, I'm going to share this. I am a disabled vet, and I did a little time in the military. I'm an ex-submarine force, machinist made egg gang, engineer. And while I was under that ocean in that submarine, we were at war with Iraq, and we were East Coast sailors. We were deep under the ocean. They disabled me because of the lung disease the man-made atmosphere caused while I was under the ocean years ago. But I remember crying out to the Lord while I was sick, congested, having a hard time breathing. I was stuck in that submarine until we surfaced. And I remember talking with the Lord, saying, Lord, you know, man wasn't made to go this deep under the ocean. Can you hear my prayers? I didn't know my Bible then. I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of soldiers out in the field that come to know the Lord very quickly. And we're all at different levels in our walk. They may not have the truth that we're holding here today. I didn't have it then. But I realize now that God only judges us according to the light that we're walking in.
Amen.
So let's remember our brothers and sisters in the military abroad. Talking about a different war. By the way, I'm going to be preaching to y'all, and I'm also preaching to the community. We're recording the services. We're going to post them on Facebook and also YouTube. So what I say applies to a broad audience, not just to our little church here, okay? So as I'm preaching, I'm also going to be preaching to those who may view this at a later time. We are at war. And it's serious. You know, we're so worried about rumors of war and the things that are going on in this world. We need to be worried about something a little bit more sinister. Powers of darkness are working. They are working. And we are surrounded by the walking dead. I know y'all seen the movie. I hadn't watched it all. But the dead are walking all around us, and they're closing in on us. It's the spiritually wicked. Those who are doing what God hates. They're ushering in things, apostasies, which go against God's word. And they're dragging our governments down and our society to rock bottom.
Amen.
We're on a downward slope right now. I love everyone in here. I love everyone on this Gulf Coast. We're not at war with flesh and blood. We're at war with spiritual darkness. Who rules the hearts? As far as me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I will not conform to the worldliness that's going on. And I won't allow it to come upon my brothers and sisters in our churches. I'm going to preach against it. Every step of the way to my dying breath, I'm going to stand against it. We today need to start putting on our armory. Start outfitting yourself now, because this ride is going to get bumpy. This ride is about to get very bumpy. Start preparing yourself and your battle armament. It's time now, not later. Do it now, because bad things are going to come up on us in the future. If you're waiting to prepare then, you're going to be caught unfit. And you're not going to be ready for what's coming up on you. That's what this is about. We are surrounded by the walking dead. There's a storm coming. If you know there's a hurricane coming, what do?
Prepare.
You prepare. You block your windows. You get water. You gather food. You get gas. You go get your generator. If you know the storm is coming, why are we sleeping? Why are we we laying around sleeping? Get your battle armament on. I'm going to show y'all something today. That's going to be the first step in preparing your battle armament. And it all deals with God and His grace and His mercy. It has nothing to do with any pastor, any man, any denomination, any government. It's all about you and God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
That's what we need to be seeking. I'm going to tell y'all, I hear so many people tell me, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. And if I'm being offensive, it's not me. I'm going to tell y'all, in the video land, that I don't judge anyone. I speak the words of Jesus. Amen. He says, He does not judge you. The words He spoke will be your judge.
Amen.
So the words I speak are not mine, but my Lord's. They'll be your judge. They'll be our judge, all of us. So how do we put on our battle armament? Would it be your desire to put it on?
Amen.
Amen. Do you know, I hear people say, I am Catholic. I am Seventh-day Adventist. I am Protestant. All I really want to hear is I am a Christian.
Amen.
I am a Christian. And I mean more than just the lips. Show me in your actions. Amen. Don't just speak it, live it. Show that you're a Christian. You know God's testing y'all? He's seeing if you're fit for the kingdom of heaven. By your actions. If you speak it, your heart feels it. There are some that will speak it, but their hearts are far from God. Draw near to Him, that He may draw near to you. A lot of conformity happening. Do you know when Jesus ascended, I didn't even begin my sermon yet. When Jesus ascended into heaven, peace I leave with you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you, is what He says. That word peace, what about the whole world hollering, unity, unity. Do we want unity? Do we want to conform with worldliness? You know them by their fruits. Test all spirits. If it's not according to the law and the testimony, it's not of God. John says the true church, and I'm going to shake y'all a little bit. The true church has two characteristics in the book of Revelation. Two. She will be a commandment-keeping people with the testimony of Jesus Christ. There it is. I hear so many of my brothers and sisters in the SDA church tell me, I have the spirit of prophecy. We have the spirit of prophecy. Okay, great. Give me one scripture from the Old Testament. The testimony of Jesus Christ. Is it in your heart? Do you know it? I don't give very many answers. They want to look to a prophetess here and now. John wrote about then and what was prophesied beforehand. We have the testimony, spirit of prophecy, the testimony of Jesus Christ. There's the characteristic. It is the faith of Jesus. Did y'all know there are 350 plus prophecies which perfectly fulfill the crucifixion of Christ thousands of years before it happened?
Amen.
That's the testimony of Jesus. That's the evidence of your hope. King David, who was before Christ 2,000 years in the book of Psalms, chapter 22, says he prophesied of Christ's crucifixion. Did y'all know the Roman crucifixion did not exist in his day? It was invented by man. But he wrote about it perfectly 2,000 years earlier. Study your Bibles. Build your confidence. Stand sure on that foundation. which is the cornerstone, Jesus Christ. You have to stand sure. That's the spirit of prophecy I want to see. I love what I read by some of these prophets and prophetesses, as long as they're following and walking after Christ. I want to see the true spirit of prophecy on the testimony of Christ, the true church. Better keep your focus on Jesus. This ride is getting ready to be bumpy, and it's going to get worse. Put on your battle armament. There's a storm coming. Prepare. I can't stress that enough. Start preparing that you can stand in that evil day that comes upon you, which is near to us all. So, there's lots of dead. But don't take my word for it. Let's look at what the Bible says. Those dead in their sins. Let's turn with me to Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2. 1 through 14. And you have he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins. How many of us who were born under the first Adam are dead in their trespasses and sins? All of us, right? How does the Bible trace genealogies? Through the mother or the father? Who's the first Adam? He was created by Jesus, right? He's the first Adam. He's the father of humanity. Who is the second Adam? Jesus Christ. The Bible's clear on this. Who is his father? Was he born under another man in the likeness of the first Adam? Or is his genealogy traced straight to the power of God, which overshadowed Mary? That's why he's the second Adam. Keep your focuses on Jesus. So we are all born with this sin. And the Bible's clear on this. We were all dead in trespasses and sin, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this what?
World.
According to the prince of the power of the air. Who is the prince of the power of this air?
Satan
still has ownership right now. He's still ruler over this world until Christ returns. Among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lusts of our flesh. You hear what I'm saying? Fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Pretty powerful words, isn't it? Let's go to prayer.
Holy Father, I ask that only your words be heard here today. Remove this wretched man that I am, and allow only you to shine through with what you want your church to hear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I'm like Paul. I die daily. Crucify the flesh. We're going to talk more on this. I will not read on, but if y'all would like to write these verses down as we go, please do, and then follow up later. Or you have my email. You can reach me on Facebook, YouTube, or you can simply call me on my phone. However you like. I will respond to any of you anytime. If you don't get me, leave me a message. Okay. Ephesians, let's go to Ephesians 2, 14, 22. I'm going to read this part here. 14 through 22. For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Who has he made us one with? The Father, God. That's exactly right. You know, in the Hebrew, that, and the Greek, rather, that word, peace I leave with you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Do you know the whole world's yelling out right now? Peace, peace, come together in unity. But they're conforming to wicked ways. And they're opposing what these Bibles teach us. I will speak against the Protestant churches every step of the way, as long as they are a false prophet teaching against what this says. If it doesn't agree with this, I'm not going along with it. Isaiah says, test all spirits. The apostle says, test all spirits. I'm saying, make sure and test all the spirits.
Yeah.
According to this. Not according to what man says. That is going to be your safety. So right here in 14 through 22, by the way, this word peace in the Greek, as Jesus spoke it as he ascended into heaven, means prosperity. It means to be quiet, to rest. All right? Plus, joined together and made one. There's your difference. It's not as the world giveth. You're made one with his Father through him. Peace I giveth unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. There's your difference. Follow after Christ. 14 through 22. Having abolished in the flesh the enmity, even the law of the commandments contained in ordinances, for to make him one in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. And that he might reconcile both unto God in one body. Didn't I just speak this? This is the peace he's leaving with. By the cross. We're going there today. We're all going to take a little walk to the cross of Christ today. And it's going to be the first step in outfitting yourselves with the whole armory of God. And that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. Isn't that interesting? And came and preached peace to you, which were afar off, and to them which were nigh. Are we afar off? We're afar off.
Yeah.
He preached it to us right here. He preserves his word for a day as this, for your hearings. Isn't that something? Beautiful. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the who?
Father.
Now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. How many of us want to be fellow citizens in that household?
Amen.
Amen. Now y'all heard several things mentioned here, and it kept going back to the cross. Kept going to the cross, right? By the way, our church is dead today. We have many dead churches. They're conforming to the world. They're living worldly. They're dressing worldly. Guard God's holy day lightly. John, in the book of Revelation, said the true church has the testimony of Jesus, and she keeps the commandments of God. Isn't that something? Please remember this. Don't take it lightly. Let it be written upon your hearts and placed into your minds. We can't do it in our strength. I'm going to show you this today. So this is the walking dead. They're all around us. It should be your heart's desire to love the things Christ loves. Reach out to your communities. We'll talk more about this. Reach out to them who are lost. What happens in Judgment Day when you are going into the kingdom and they're perishing on the earth, and they look at you and say, you knew and you never told me? You had these truths and I'm here perishing now? What a sad time that'll be, huh? Share the truth. Don't be shy. Oh, let me rephrase that. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Amen. You know what he says about that? We're going to cover it. Colossians 2, 11 through 13. In whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of
Christ.
By the circumcision of, please say it again.
Christ.
Okay, that's the circumcision. Not made by hands. Buried with him in baptism. What does he say? Lest you be born of the water and of the Spirit, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Lest we be born of the water and of the blood, we will not enter. There's a lot I can say about that, but not today. Wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. Who raised Jesus from the dead? What does the Bible say right here? Who is God? That's Jesus' Father. He raised him from the dead. Isn't that something? And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your what?
Flesh.
Okay, right now I've learned. The circumcision made without hands is Christ. And now I'm finding out that ye who are uncircumcised are in the flesh. The second Adam was made a quickening spirit. A quickening spirit. For us all. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Beautiful words, isn't it? Turn with me to Titus 1. Verse 10. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the That would be those who are within the church. Did y'all want to know? I got to share this with you. It would be much better. It would be much better for you if you didn't know this truth. If you profess to be a Christian and you know the truth and your heart's far from God, you who Christ has circumcised in justification, it would be much better for you that you hadn't ever heard in the eyes of God. Isn't that something? For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers. These are the things God hates. And it's taking place in our churches. In all our churches. You know why? They're dead. They're dead churches. You know why they're dead churches? They don't go before the foot of the cross. Humble themselves before God and allow their characters to be transformed. Receiving His grace. There's going to be people that speak evil of you when you follow Christ. Guard the mouth. Guard your mouth. Because those who are without judgments is for God only. Remember that. I'm going to show you all some things today. whose mouths must be what?
Stop.
Who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not, for filthy lucre's sake, for money's sake, tickling the ears of the hearers. One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, the Christians are always liars, evil beasts, slow bellies. This witness is true. Wherefore rebuke them sharply. Judgment for those who are within, or for the wise. Those are for those in within. We need to be watchful. Be on guard. Test all spirits. Watch those around you in the churches. You need to be more worried about some of the folks in the churches than you do those that are without. Now, I'm not saying that about our church, because I feel completely comfortable in this church. I know each and every one of you. I don't know everybody viewing this. But I feel comfortable here. Be on guard. Turn with me to Matthew 15, 3 and 9. So there's two categories of the walking dead. Those who are outside the church, and there's the walking dead who's managed to come into the church. Matthew 15, 3 through 9. But he answered, and this is Jesus speaking, but he answered and said unto them, why do ye also transgress the commandment of God by your traditions? How many of our churches are transgressing the commandments of God by their traditions? There's many churches, many denominations. God's going to hold them accountable if they've been given the light, especially those ministers, those pastors, and those preachers. They're going to be held accountable. I am going to speak the truth. No matter what, I'm going to share truth. I am not ashamed of the gospel of my Lord and Savior. He is mine, and I am his. And this is where I'm going to stand to the end. And Jesus said, are ye also yet without understanding? Do not ye yet understand that whatsoever entereth in the mouth goeth out to the belly and cast out into the draught? But those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart, and they defile the man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornication, thefts, false witness, and blasphemies. Wow! Did y'all know that your father hates these things? Now, when you were children growing up, every one of us has a dad here, right? For the most part, everyone either had a father or a father figure. You knew the things that your parents hated, right? Right? And you knew that you wanted to avoid... Okay, I'll tell y'all like this. I know that I wanted to avoid the things my dad hated. He was very loving to make sure that you don't do it again. Why not know the things that your father hates? That's the first step. Learn what he hates. Learn what he loves. Follow after him. Jesus says, I am the way. Walk as he walked. Look at your example. Isn't that important? That's two categories of the dead. I'm not going to go through all these verses because time is not going to permit. There's a third category of the dead. We talked about the walking dead everywhere. We talked about the dead in our churches. And I'm talking about all denominations. Now, let's talk about those who are sincerely following Christ. they're dead in a different way. The others are dead in their sins according to the flesh. I die daily. I die daily. I have to take up my cross and follow Christ. Well, how many of y'all ever questioned, how do I die daily to this? I'm going to tell you how. Know the things He hates. Know the thing God hates. Jesus says very clearly in several scriptures, I'm only going to cover a couple of these. If y'all, for those who are taking notes, I'm going to call the scriptures out. And you can take notes, or you can email me, you can call me, you can message me, back message me, and I'll give you the notes if you like. The scripture readings are 1 Corinthians 28:34, Mark 8:34 through 36, Luke 9:25 through 27, Luke 14:25 through 30, Galatians 5:24.
You're going too quick.
Right, where are you at?
I guess Luke
would be good. Luke 9:25 through 27. Luke 14:25 through 30. Galatians 5:24 through 25. 1 Peter 2:23 through 25. I'm going to read a few of these to you. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians 28. You know, I had forgotten to write down the chapter that's in. I'll have to get back with you on that one. Turn with me to Mark 8. And when he had called the people unto himself, unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And who shall ever lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. Yeah. The testimony of Jesus Christ. In John chapter 6, verse 57, he says that the words he speak are spirit and they are life. That's the testimony of Jesus Christ also. He also says in John chapter 6, unless you see him, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. I've asked people in churches, have you seen Christ? How many of y'all seen Christ?
Daily.
Daily. It means to behold him with the mind's eye. He says, abide in his word. Abide in him. Because this is a quickening spirit for your soul. Nutrition, spiritual nutrition. Turn with me to Luke 9:25 through 27. Chapter 9. For what is a man advantaged if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away? For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, there it is again, Jesus Christ and the gospel. Whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed. Do y'all want Jesus ashamed of you? No. when he shall come in his glory, his own glory, and in his Father's. So Jesus is going to come in his own glory and also in the glory of his Father. And of the holy angels. But I tell you the truth, there be some standing here which shall not taste death until they see the kingdom of God. Can we see the kingdom of God today? Can we behold the kingdom of God? Stay in the Word. Abide in His Word. You can behold it. 1 Peter 2:23. Toward the back of our Bibles, 1 Peter 2:23. Who, when he was reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. Who did Jesus commit himself to? Himself? To the Father. He committed himself and all his ways to his Father. We should hide ourselves in Jesus. Commit our ways and ourselves to Jesus. He's the veil between us and the Father. He's the cleft of the rock that we find ourselves hidden in. That's our protection between us and a holy God. It's our only way into salvation. We cannot overtake the city and gain right to the tree of life in our own strength. Not going to happen. Satan will promise those lies. Not going to happen. And he's making those same promises today to some of those who would call themselves the elite. Oh, is this aired publicly? I'm not ashamed. I'm going to speak the truth all the way. Verse 25, for ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and the bishop of your souls. Our time is short. What is truth? What is truth? Jesus tells Pilate at the judgment seat, at Pilate's judgment seat, I came to testify of the truth. Did he say this? What is truth? The testimony of Jesus Christ. But more than that, also the commandments of God. Let's go and look at what King David writes, Psalm 85. I haven't even got to the good stuff yet. We're not there yet. I'm going to share something with y'all today that's very beautiful. Turn with me to Psalm 85. This is a prophecy by King David also. Another one of his prophecies. Psalm 85. All nations, 86, that's the wrong verse. 85, 9 to 13. Surely his salvation is nigh them that fear him. What is the fear of the Lord? It is moral reverence. That's what the fear of the Lord is, moral reverence. It's to reverend him. It's to love what our Lord loved and to hate the things that God hates. Study. Surely his salvation is nigh them that fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Is glory dwelling in our land today? The United States is on a downhill spiral. They're ushering in every abominable bird, caged bird there is. You know what that is? The attack birds. The hate. What do you mean hate? I don't hate anybody. But God tells us in Exodus, who hates him? Who could possibly hate God? He says in the second commandment, in the book of Exodus, Those who are committing iniquity hate him. Wow, he tells us. He also tells us what he hates. I don't want to be found hating, and I don't want to be found doing the things he hates. That's the fear of the Lord. Moral reverence. Study your father. Study how Jesus walked. This is the way, walk ye in it. Mercy and truth. All right, I'm going to rephrase that for you. Mercy and justification. Mercy and justice. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. That's to be made one with the Father. That's the righteousness of the earth meeting the flesh of the earth rising up to meet the righteousness of God. Peace I leave with you. Not as the world give I unto you. He makes us one with his Father. He's making us one with his Father and himself. Truth shall spring out of the earth. By the way, there it is again back here in verse 10. The two characteristics of our true church shall be a commandment-keeping people who have the testimony of Jesus. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. There it is. Jesus Christ and the gospel shall spring out of the earth. Are you children of the second Adam? Are you children of the second Adam? That's where we want to be. I'm going to show y'all something. I die daily. How many times y'all heard me say that today? Several times. Let's move on. Maybe put that diagram up on the screen here. I want y'all to look at this picture. Y'all see this?
Yes.
All right. This is a picture in a sanctuary. It's also a picture of the cross. It's also a picture of all the articles of furniture. I'm not going to go into a great depth on this right now, but I'm going to show you how we go to that cross with Christ. Many scriptures say, take up your cross and follow after me. Crucify the flesh. Circumcision of the flesh is in who? Jesus Christ. Prepare your battle armor. This is the first stage. Turn with me to Proverbs chapter 6. Proverbs chapter 6. In conclusion. The Lord has pressed upon my conscience all week, ever since he showed me this truth last week. These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. There's many abominable things coming up on us. Can we fill that cup of iniquity, the cup of lawlessness, and our probation be sealed thereafter shortly for eternity? Do you want to be found in the state of total abomination before the eyes of God? No. None of us want to be there. These six things doth our Father hate. Y'all like whippings? You like to be punished? Don't do the things that make God upset at you. He's our Father, Jesus, our Savior. A proud look. I'm going to just call them out. I'm not even going to read scriptures. You have them in front of you. It's a proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift to run to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he who sows discord among brethren. Oh, there's the dead inside the church. How many people do that? How many people has a heart that the advised wickedness, who is so fast to run to mischief, to get involved, and they go out with their forward mouth and their proud look, with all their pride and arrogance and conceited ways, to shed innocent blood. How many people we know like that? How many of those characteristics do we have naturally within ourselves? All of them. Die daily. God doesn't do anything that's not divine. He doesn't speak a word of inspiration that's not divine inspiration, divine word. Look right here. You see this cross? A proud look, pride, arrogance, the evil way, the froward mouth. Where is Jesus' head? He was wounded for our sins. He put on the crown of thorns. Guard your mouths. God hates a proud look. Do you know pride will not let you come to the foot of the cross before the mercy seat where God's presence is to receive His grace, which is the oil that keeps your lamp burning? God hates pride. He says, humble yourselves. Humble yourselves before Him. Die daily. Take up your cross. A proud look. A lying tongue. Where are my hands? Hands that shed innocent blood, physically and spiritually. Let them be nailed to the cross with Christ. Instead of having hands that shed innocent blood, I stretch out my arms, I take up my cross, I put on that helmet of salvation, that crown of thorns, to follow my Maker and my Master. And I stretch out my hands with Him, and I let Him be nailed to the cross. And in my right hand, I take up the glory of God. And in my left hand, I take hold of the Spirit of life. And this is what I bring to the walking dead. Outfit yourselves with the armory of God. Put it on. A heart that deviseth wicked imaginations. How can you protect against that? Our hearts are naturally evil. The altar of incense. It is the spirit of supplication. Plant yourself on the cross with Christ. Get on your knees. And be in constant prayer. You can't even neglect prayer for 1 hour without being tempted. Do you know that?
Amen.
Talk every hour to Christ, even when you're not on your knees. Jesus is a close personal friend. He is walking with you because you have made a commitment to stretch yourself out on the cross with Him and to be buried with Him and crucify this flesh that you can become a quickened a heart that devises wicked imaginations. But then he goes straight to your feet. Plant your feet on the platform of eternal truth. Plant them on the platform of eternal truth. My feet are nailed to that cross of my Savior. I'm not going to run to mischief. Very quickly, I'm reminded when I am crucified daily not to do it. What about he who bears false witness and speaketh lies? Altar sacrifice. Gird up your loins with the belt of truth. Did they speak lies against Christ? Did they bear false witness to plant Him here? Go to the altar of sacrifice. Put on that belt of truth. And then the last but not least, he who sows discord among brethren. Unless you be born of the water and of the Spirit. That brass labor right here in his side is exactly where the soldier pierced his side and forthwith gained blood and water.
Yeah.
That brass labor is blood and water. It's where the high priest would wash his hands. You know what it is? You are unified into one body, which is Christ. That's your only safety. That's the peace you want. Not as the world gave it, but as Christ gave. That's the unity we seek for. On a daily basis, we should crucify our flesh. Understand what God hates. And take up your cross and follow after Him. Walk as He walked. What man goes to war without weighing the cost in advance? People, we're at war. Put on your battle armor. Weigh the cost. See if you're willing to pay everything.
Holy Father, I give praise and thanks unto you this day for the truth you have brought to us. I praise you and bless you with all that we are, which is very little. But my heart is to you, and I feel that there are many others. We offer our hearts to you. We ask that you keep us as your children as we commit our ways to you and to following after your beautiful Son who came for us. In Jesus' name, I pray for every person in here and all those who are watching. I pray for this entire Gulf Coast and as far out as you will be willing to let us be used to your great name, honor, and glory. Amen.
I guess my appeal here today is that all of us seek after Christ in His ways. Follow after Him. Take up our cross and follow Him. And our daily walk, crucified flesh. If any of you have any questions, or like to call or contact our ministry, prayer, your study, your answers, your questions, anything that you want. We're always here for you, myself and yours.